Hello, good evening. Welcome to this very special edition. In an unfamiliar territory, this is the rich hospital that President Mahama will be commissioning tomorrow, one of the fine edifices created by the government, but of course, coming with some controversy because the opposition are worried about the cost of the hospital. This election has been the contest for change versus the contest for continuity based on infrastructure. The NDC has been campaigning heavily on infrastructure development. This is one of them. Tonight, Alexander Segbefia is the Minister of Health. He's here with us. He's hosting us, actually, because this is more his territory than ours. So tell us about all the infrastructure in the health sector and also general politicking. How's the campaign going?
Very good, we would say. We are confident. All the structures and issues that we've put in place are bearing fruit. And we are quietly confident that we will have victory come the 7th of December.
President Mahama will win again.
We are quietly confident that that is what is going to happen. And we think that it will be quite clearly a one-touch victory. There will be no second round. And I think well-deserved, because there's no doubt in some of our minds, and for the majority of Ghanaians, I would say, that love him or hate him, you must respect him for what he's been able to deliver.
What is the essence of this hospital, this rich hospital? Why should people be happy about it when, if you go to 37 tomorrow morning, you will find queues and you find people in deplorable state? You probably will find that in Komfanochi, in some Sunyani hospital. You find that in Kolibu as well. Why should people be excited that, in spite of all these difficulties, this is a brand new, maybe five-star, very posh hospital I've been around. This is very impressive. Why are we doing that? Is that how to fix the problem?
Well, Paul, I think that the first thing that has to be said is that you have a caring president who has looked at the health sector and decided that we needed to do something. Over the years, our population has grown. And for most things in this country, for a long time, you can't but mention any form of infrastructure without calling Kwame Nkrumah's name. This is way back in the 60s. Most of the infrastructure that we talked about, from our schools to our hospitals, and even the case of the hospitals, some of them were colonial. Yet our population was growing year in, year out. I saw a clip recently on WhatsApp about a lady who was trying to deliver, and they finally lost the lady because there was pressure of lack of beds, etc. These are our women, Ghanaians, dying because we don't have space. Not that there are no doctors, not that they don't have equipment, but we are overcrowded. And you had a caring president whose first priority was, look, the infrastructure in this country is still back in the 60s, and we are now 20 in the 2000s. I've got to fix it. We are in a theater, as you can see, an operating theater, brand new, ultramodern. Why shouldn't Ghana have one? What is so special about Europe or America that they should have it and we shouldn't?
Why do we still have women giving birth on the floor?
So this is the answer. We are building hospitals right across the country. There are CHIP compounds right across the country. Health centers. Everybody talks about Legon. Everybody talks about Ridge, because the aesthetics and what it contains is second to none. But there are other facilities up and down. There are 8 hospitals being built under the Eurojet project, 7 hospitals being built under the NMS project, one of which is the Dodowa Hospital. And so this is what is going to solve the problem. Now, if you came into a hospital like this, which has 12 ultra-modern theaters like this, 4 of them dedicated to emergency cases only, 2 for obstetrics, which is deliveries, and then 6 for electives.
Electives means what?
Where they book you in for operations. So the waiting time and the idea of, oh, we don't have space to do your... When they tell you, come tomorrow at 10 o'clock, you're going to be operated, you know you have a theater that you're going into. Because you now have the theaters. So all those pressures that you have with too many people in police hospital, too many people in Kolebu, Ridge is going to absorb it. The Legon new hospital will help the absorption. But you do realize that Kolebu has also now got an ultramodern accident and emergency unit. $251 million has been spent on equipment in existing hospitals. X-rays.
That's part of the problem. $251 million.
Yes.
That's a lot of money.
When you look at this, please, I can see where the money is gone. This is no fly-by-night theater or hospital.
So it's a comparison between a hospital that the Nigerian mogul Dangote had built and the Ridge hospital, and he had spent far less money.
When people make those comparisons, I smile. Look, even if you buy the same model Mercedes-Benz, same Mercedes, I'm tempted to make, do you know that they vary in price? There's no one Mercedes.
Not significantly.
Well, yes. Why? If you buy a Mercedes-Benz that is 230 and somebody goes and buys a 600 Mercedes-Benz, there's a big difference in price.
Yes, but an E-class will not be costing less than a C-class.
So what do you know is in this hospital that, and what do you know about what is in Dangote's hospital?
They compare the beds. That's what the MPP gave us. They
beds.
Compare the beds, yes. So he's doing beds. A 200 bed, you're doing a 400 bed, and it's assumed that the operating facilities will be the same.
Allow me.
Please go ahead.
You have here a 420-bed hospital. Mm. You have an imaging department that has CT scans, MRIs, fluoroscopy, ultrasound, 4D, X-rays with all their packs. So everything is digital. You move it from one to the other. There's no need now for having to print film to deal with it. No. You have here maternity now has a theater with 17 private delivery units in here. This, the issue you saw of people not being able to deliver, 17 private units.
For private delivery. Means more expensive or something like that?
They are delivery suites. And so some are okay. Not, and some are the,
so
in terms
is,
of the maternity.
So this is built to custom top range.
It's top range, but it also caters for the average person. Mm. So you have a bit of medical tourism in here, but also the ability to deal with the everyday person. Mm. Because we are moving away from the position where hospitals should always rely on government completely. We now want to wean them off. They must now begin to be able to pay their way.
So they can sell their own delivery rooms, make some money.
They can make some money. There's nothing wrong with that.
Increasing internally generated funds.
Exactly, because at the end of the IGF, it's going to increase. You're going to have people coming from abroad to use the equipment that is here. Doctors even may even be able to come in and do such selective operations because they know that the equipment is in the place. I could go on and on. I've talked about the theaters. I've talked about, we have 36 ICUs, 12 for HDUs, 12 for critical care, 12 for beds. We have two dialysis machines here. Those who need dialysis can be dealt with. You have laboratories that are up to date. We have standby generator, 5,600 kVA. We have, part of the package involves two pickups, an ambulance, a 32-seater bus, a mortuary that takes 100 bodies, brand new, it's in there. We have an anesthesia school, simulated, state of the art. When you train in that school, you come out, you can practice anywhere in the world.
Simulated means what?
You can actually go through the process as if you're almost doing it.
Okay.
As it's almost like you're going through a process that where there is a live person there, but it's not.
So train doctors from medical school?
Train anesthetists from the medical school and also from the laboratories who want to go into that field are trained here. Mm-hmm. So they have flats for doctors or for staff here. It is a complete package. And so, like I said, if you want to compare, you have to go and see what is in. The engine is what matters. That's the point I was making about the vehicle. Mm-hmm. The engine, what is in the engine? What actually moves the car? What are the features of the car? That changes the price. You can buy a car that is $20,000. And if they decide to soup it up and put all the extras on it, you might have to pay $60,000. That's the difference. So that comparison doesn't fit. But more importantly, are we saying that the MPs on the MPP side don't know what they are talking about? It was approved. It went to Parliament. It was challenged. Value for money was done. They said there was too much on this thing. It was reduced. Certain equipment and other things were asked to be upgraded. It's been through the whole process. So it's not a one-sided affair where the one government brings it and it goes through. It involves the whole of Parliament. And that is why, let me give you a history about some of these issues. When we first started talking about our infrastructure, the MPP said, it's not true. So some good people in the NDC decided to create a green book. The green book now showed photographs. These were the things that existed. And so all of a sudden it was, oh no, it was too expensive. Then they said, no. When they said it was too expensive, their own MPs came out and said, no. It came through us. We agreed it. It's not too expensive. So they then turned around and said, we didn't need it. We don't need it. The media and the public said, we need it. They realized they were going down the wrong road. So they backed off from, we don't need it. You know the next thing I heard?
No.
By the way, the loans you used to buy it, we contracted them. The MPP now turned around and said, they contracted the loans that we needed to build the hospitals. So I ask you, who is confused? You started from a point where they didn't exist. And now you've gone through the whole shebang. And when I was on Joy FM, my colleague who was with me clearly said, oh, by the way, the loans you contracted to do these hospitals, most of them were contracted under the MPP.
But is that true, though?
It is not. The Eurojet project is the only one where an initial contract was signed and was gone through. But even the financial took 2-3 years for us to actually sort.
But you cited the Eurojet in your introduction.
Yes, but I'm saying that it is the only set of hospitals where they had been involved in the initial contract. And that was done 1 month before we came into office in 2009. And there were difficulties with it. So we had to rehash, go through. But we had already signed the contract. And the hospitals are going on. But the 7 NMS, the Legon Hospital, Ridge Hospital, which we are in, they had no hand in that. The cheap compounds we've built, they had no hand in that. The polyclinics that are going up, they had no hand in that. So why all of a sudden, when you have nowhere to go, do you decide? And anyway, the point I'm trying to make is this. They don't know whether they are coming or going. They had to find something to say wrong about healthcare. And there's nothing wrong. Why don't you for once just say, look, we think that this is in the right direction and look for something else to hit. The problem, and we'll come to the politics, is that there's nowhere else to hit. You go to the law, new courtrooms have been built. You look for water, at Denta you put on a tap, the water is flowing. You go for transport, the airport is beautiful. And we have aircraft locally going up and down. Railway, new railway is going. You look at...
You are saying there is a comprehensive infrastructure.
There has been a comprehensive infrastructural drive as well as economic drive that has been done by His Excellency John Dramani Mahama.
We'll come to that. Let me interrupt you and take a first break. So that's Alex Segbefia. That's our introduction. We're going into the matters. We are at the Ridge Hospital. We are in one of the theaters here at the Ridge Hospital. Watch out for that. It will be opened by the President tomorrow. After the break, we continue.
One thing I was clear about. Governments lose elections. Opposition don't win them. Opposition puts itself in readiness to take over power when the government has decided that it doesn't want it anymore and starts misbehaving.
Misbehaving?
Yes.
Misbehaving is the word you're using.
I've used the words misbehaving.
Yeah, misbehaving. Yes. When governments misbehave.
Begin to misbehave and take the electorate for granted. Mm-hmm. Then opposition must be in readiness ready to take it.
Welcome back to the program, and I still have Minister Alex Segbefia, Minister of Health, with me. The last time we spoke to you, you said something which we have played as a clip, that you said governments don't lose elections, oppositions don't win elections, government lose it if they don't govern properly. By what we are hearing, people dissatisfied, they don't have food in their they don't have food in their stomach, they don't have money in their pocket. There's corruption in NDC, etc., etc. That's what the opposition says people are saying. Do you get a sense that if you were to mark your government, you will say that they have delivered?
Clearly, I would say we've delivered, and that is actually why we will win this election. It's based simply on the delivery. As for the opposition saying, making comments, I don't expect them to say different. The point is that people have to look at the facts and then make decisions for themselves. And the facts say otherwise. We have a manifesto, and for the increasingly election by election, people are being asked to account for what they've promised the people. And there is no doubt that a greater portion of the manifesto and its promises have been met. And that doesn't even take account of crises that existed. For example, the Dumsoy issue. You have to doff your hat to President Mahama for strength and tenacity and a dogged approach to solving that particular problem. And the truth be known now that, as your previous guest made clear, our generation capacity exceeds our demand. So if there's any issue about outages, it has to do with either the transmission side or getting it from ECG.
Because people are still getting outages.
Yes, it has to do with the transmission side. It's not a production, a lack of facilities to produce. It's more, if at all, sometimes a lack of getting the right fuel from A to B, etc. But in terms of our ability to generate, which was actually the main issue, we don't have that problem in Ghana anymore.
Let's get to the infrastructure issue. You talked about Adenta water flowing.
Yes.
When the government of President Kufuor was exiting, they told us that in Cape Coast, there was never water in Cape Coast. They provided water. They had done the Cape Coast Yamarasa Road, which had been on the Kwame Prepare budget for a long time. They had done different things. They've done some roads here. They built some infrastructure here. The point I'm making is that every government sort of delivers some infrastructure. Does infrastructure actually win elections?
I disagree with your use of the term some. What we have done is not some. Please.
But every government has done it.
Yeah, but they may have done some. We haven't done some.
You got more money.
We've made sure that we have put ourselves in a position where people are able to give us the money because we know what it's going to be used for. They're happy with what we are using it for. They've done
but
value
they
for money.
They give the money to you. They gave it to Ghana because Ghana has been on a democratic streak.
But we are talking
for
of government from one government to the next government.
Yes, but the reason
and
why
you have
getting
to make
the
your
money,
case.
But the credibility that you are getting the money for is because of the government and the people of Ghana have stayed democracy the course since 1992, and we are admired worldwide. So you were the government at the time that we got to this height of democracy.
I disagree with
elections.
You, but even if I went with your analogy, you are telling me to sell my birthright. Oh, you were born before me, so therefore you shouldn't inherit. That you can't do that. It's not acceptable. It's the bottom line is simply this. If you don't have a good front, you don't get the money. You have to show a good credibility factor to be able to get access to the funding. And President Mahama has done this. There is no excuse. So the sum doesn't come into
it. So you have done more infrastructure than
he has done
before.
A lot of. Since Kwame Nkrumah, no one. Let's check the. How many hospitals did the MPP build?
I don't know.
Thank you. The word is zero. How many schools?
MPP didn't build any hospitals.
Where? So tell me.
They didn't renovate any hospitals.
So why aren't they talking about it?
They didn't do anything to call it.
I said, where are the hospitals? I'm asking. I mean, if you. We have built, we are telling you, we are in Ridge. Look at the theater. We are going to look at Legon.
You've made additions to Ridge. Legon is fresh, but you made additions to Ridge. Ridge has always been there.
Yes, but this is an ultramodern. What we have built is a brand new hospital.
Didn't Richard Anani sitting in your chair make statements about how they have improved hospitals?
And I'm saying, tell us.
Okay.
I'm
sure they are listening to
I'm
you.
I'm here to tell you what NDC has done. Mm-hmm. And mine is very clear. And it's I just gave you a history of how they were running away from it. We showed them that it is real. They said no, it's not you necessary. All manner of things. Now they say, even say they went to take their loans. I mean, this infrastructure, hospitals, cheap compounds, polyclinics, second to none. Schools. They say, oh, you built only 100 and you haven't even built 123. We say 123 at various phases. Oh, you haven't built. So we say, how many did you build? You also had 8 years. How many? You tell us. You can't. So even on a comparison basis, it doesn't hold water.
But if you look at the amount of
money
they got.
And when you see the edifices that are the schools, the M or E blocks as you want, I mean, everything is in the school. Just like this hospital. Everything that is needed is in it. So it isn't just people, we need a school, you put it up. It has been thought through. Vision in what has been built exists. We've been in this country how many years? And every time we pass Lavender Hill, that on its own, that singular fecal liquid waste disposal plant, I doff my hat to President Mahama. That one on its own. Second interchange, which now Kasua is raising his head. Why? When it comes to infrastructure.
But in interchanges, Dr. Baumia says the MPP built 8. You have done 2.
If you go to roads, the roads is a remarkable record. Accra, Yamuransa, Accra, Flao, Kejebu, Pepesu, Mansu, Asankragua, Exim, Jansen, Takwa, Abuakwa, Bibiani, Tinga, Bole, Pantai, Manfi, Pandu, Raura, Winchi, Sampa, Tamale, Yendi, Malam, Interchange, Tetokwashi, Malam, Jasikam, Brokese, Exim, Jansen, Takwa, Pantang, Manfi, Tetokwashi, Interchange, Ashima, Motorway, Achimota, Interchange, Alajo, Avano, Asafu, Interchange,
He lists the interchanges. He says they did 8 interchanges and you did 2. And you are making noise about that too.
You see, sometimes I don't. You are comparing. Okay, you did 8 interchanges. Where are these interchanges, and what? Why is nobody jumping up and down about it? Second was a major, major issue in this country, year in, year out. So the second interchange has changed the lives of, and there is very few people who ever come to Accra having passed through second. Either from the
that is correct,
end,
but does it negate the 8 interchanges so, that they put up?
So where are these? Well, I know about the
Tetekwashi,
yes.
Sofo line.
Yeah. But Sofo line, who did they finish Sofo line?
I don't know, but he mentions
Sofo line is if you don't mention Sofo line, it's not their credit.
Mm.
Yeah, it's not their credit. Don't mention Sofo line because Sofo line was dealt with on GOG.
Accra Kumasi
and they couldn't do anything with it. They had to leave Sofo. You know
the Accra Kumasi dualization.
Yes.
They did it.
Really?
Yes.
But I thought they said it's not finished, and we haven't finished it.
Yeah, it's
so which
finished,
so which
but,
is it?
You see, but it did a significant.
No. You can't have your cake and eat it.
Achimota Interchange.
Which Achimota?
On the Kumasi Road in Sawam, that place, completely changed. Now you go to Kumasi without
the
going.
The A41.
That's what you call it.
Yeah, okay. I mean that's the, a George nice Bush, name. The George Bush Highway.
Not George Bush. We go to Kumasi without going through in Sawam town.
Oh, the in, oh,
that one.
We finished it.
Oh, you finished it, but
yes,
they started.
Yes.
It. Okay.
Yeah. I'm only saying that because if you remember when the A41 George Bush Highway was done, mm-hmm. we invited Kufuor when we finished it because of the amount of work they had done to deal with it. We invited him.
So you recognize that they
so
did something.
So we recognize that they did some
infrastructure.
Yes, but
based on the amount of money they got and based on the amount of money you got, if we were to work out the ratios, who has done better?
Paul, let's start from the position of the money.
Mm.
If you go to your bank manager and he gives you 50 million, and I go to my bank manager and he gives me 75 million. Why should you be angry? He's looked at you and decided whether you are credit worthy or not. Mm. And he decided to give you 50. Because of what I may or what I am able to go and say to mine, he gives me 75. So don't make that comparison. It's almost as if, oh, what they got, this is what they got, and what. No. We have put our case and we got the money that we got. In the same way that people say, oh, well, the economy has challenges and therefore you have this thing. We don't go around saying, oh, you spoiled the economy before. We said, look, we came, these were the challenges. We have global issues. We are looking at it and dealing with it. You take what you get, the credits and the debits.
There's a critical comparative analysis, a comparative platform, Alex, about this election anyway, between you and the MPP.
Yes.
So the MPP say that, okay, so they did infrastructure.
Yes.
They didn't do circle, but they did something.
Yes.
And people remember that there was money in their pocket. People remember that business was flowing. People remember that they were not borrowing at 28%. People remember that banks were chasing them for loans. The two worked in combination. NDC, yes, you've done Circle, you've done Rich Hospital, you've done that. No money. People have to borrow at 28%. Businesses are collapsing. They are dying. Is it a true comparison?
No. Because the banks are still chasing people for money.
Oh, they are.
The fact that the interest rate is not good is a different matter.
Mm.
But they are chasing them for money.
Okay.
So they will chase you for the money if you have a job. But it doesn't mean that you might decide not to take the money because you're not happy with the interest rate.
Mm.
And the interest rate has gone up and down. And the financial aspect of it is that when you look at our financial record over the 8 years in comparison to theirs, we have a case to make. Mm. And so I don't buy into that necessarily. I agree there are challenges. But the challenges have come as a result of successes. If there is no situation where there are no challenges. If not, then by now America and Britain and Germany would have become stagnant. If you go there now, you find that they have challenges. But they are considered better than, in terms of their economic position, better than us. But they have challenges. Why do they have challenges? Do you ever reach a finality?
No,
so you look at what has, if the problems are the same old problems, created, is existing from when you came, then you have a case, you can begin to argue it. These are not the same old problems. When you talk about a hospital like this, when somebody says, oh, what are the problems? Are we going to get all the nurses and doctors we need to run it? What is the running cost? How are we going to fund it? That is a new problem because of the existence of the hospital. It is not, if the hospital was not here, you'll be saying, oh, look, there are too many crowded people in this other hospital. There are too many crowded people here. Now you have the hospital, the crowd is gone. How do you run the hospital? It's a different problem. And that problem should not be seen as a negative to the people who created the solution for the first one. So the problems they are talking about are new problems.
Mm-hmm.
They are not talking of the old ones. The old ones have been solved. People don't talk about doomsaw too much now. Why? Because there's light. And they know that it is more constant than it was.
But 4 years of doomsaw has crippled people's businesses. Doomsaw has been with Ghana for 20 years or so.
I'm grateful you said that.
But this has been a 4 years debilitating period where people's businesses have collapsed, that they will need 3 years
but
to
you
pick
see,
it up.
The beauty,
organizers, hairdressers, they're gone.
The beauty of it is you made the point. It has been the end between the last 4 years has been the problem, but it has been there for over 20 years.
It has been, yes.
And in that 20 years, you've had NDC, you've had MPP, yeah. You've had NDC.
But it didn't last for 4 years.
So I just give credit to President Mahama, who said, no, enough is enough. I'll fix it.
How do we know that it has been fixed?
Because you look at the generating capacity of your plants.
But the lights are still going up for 2 days.
There are many reasons. Because you have transmission with Gridco, you have the ECG who gives you the light, and then you have, even in the production, it's not so much the power plants, but the fuel to run it. So you've got to do a number of things for us to enjoy this light that we see
here. So President Mahama didn't fix everything about it?
No, it's not that he didn't fix
it.
At the moment,
he fixed the generating part.
Yes, the generation part is intact. And there's even, the beauty of it is that he hasn't stopped. There are plans for plants to go on year in, year out as we move on, so that we don't get into the position where at least with generation, we do not have power plants sufficient to deal with our. And how did doomsaw come about? Doomsaw came about, especially in this thing, because everybody looked at Ghana, looked at the stability from 2008 onwards, and every business wanted to come in. At the time, they were saying even businesses were leaving. We asked, which are these businesses leaving? Nobody was telling us. They were just saying businesses are leaving.
So it's
been difficult.
Victims of our own success.
I couldn't have said it better. Couldn't have said. We have been victims of our own success. And this is the point I make.
Dr. Baumia has said that the whole doomsaw thing was an incompetence sort of streak from the NDC. They didn't understand the problem was money. They were chasing their own shadows and a wild goose chase of technical issues. It turned out eventually that he was right.
Eventually that he was right.
It was actually a money problem. that in terms of capacity, we had enough capacity to flow.
No.
We didn't.
But you, if you have the capacity, you know what the plans do.
Yeah, we had 2,200.
No, if you know what the plans do, that is fine. If you know what, you know a plant can give you 5,000 kilowatts, it doesn't change. What changes is whether you have the water, Akosombo Dam, to run it, or you have the gas to turn the turbines, or the crude oil. That is a different thing from saying, I don't have a plant. In this case, when the issues began, Ghana didn't have the capacity. It's John Mahama's government, and John Mahama particularly, who has made sure that now you have the plants that can deal with any. It's a different question to say, do we have the fuel? And but the plants to actually generate the power exist. And you can't run away from that from John Mahama. You must give him that credit, because nobody else did it.
We'll give him the credit. This, you're still watching Good Evening Ghana. Very interesting conversation with Alex Segbefia, Minister for Health. A very important question is coming up now. What's the state of affairs of the nurses' allowance? Is it in? Well, is it out?
It's no. Let's be clear. Mm-hmm. And I think this question was asked of President Mahama himself when he went for his interview. Mm-hmm. It's very clear. The NPP government in their own policy document before they left power had made the decision, which was a right one, that allowances were not the way forward for nurses and student loans is the way forward. It's there in black and white. It was a decision they made. We came, we saw the document, and we decided that actually this was a good policy. So we implemented the policy, and for the last 2.5 years, we had removed nurses' allowances in line with the policy that they had initiated, but they had put on paper, we came and the same with national health insurance. We did the pilot, they came and implemented the national level. Fine, continuity in government. Then we realized that there was a problem with implementing it, because you have two categories of nurses. You have the nurses that deal with certificates, you have the nurses that deal with diploma and above degrees. Those that are degrees or diploma can access student loans
from the universities.
Those that have certificates cannot. So a special committee was set up to look to see how we could deal with this issue. The committee recommended to President Mahama that, look, you need to amend the law if you want to get fair. Just amend the law so that all the students can access the student loan. In the interim, give them an allowance to carry them through while you can deal with it. So he said, okay, 150 Ghana cedis to students, nurses per month is the allowance we will give while we look at the issue regarding the student loan. So that's where we are. It's not a reinstatement.
That's what we are means what? You're giving them 150 cedis.
We said this 3 months ago, so the first tranche we gave them was 450.
Per person?
Yes, for 3 months.
For 3 months, okay.
For
what were they getting before?
I think they were getting something in the region of about 300, close
so,
to 300.
So you have reduced it?
Yes.
Why?
Because it's not the old allowance. No, it's not the principles of the old allowances, which was an incentive to bring people into nursing, are not the basis upon which we are giving the allowances now. The reason we are giving the allowances now is to help with cost of living. It's not to become an incentive for people to join nursing. There are two different issues.
So eventually you will migrate them onto the students' loans scheme?
Yes.
Okay. Another big issue is the National Health Insurance. The MPP says on their platforms that it has collapsed. They have advertisements, political advertisements, saying that they handed over the National Health Insurance to you. It was one of the flagship programs of President Kufuor. It was one of their points of pride when they campaigned. They actually also had a policy where pregnant women could give birth without paying. Government was paying for that. That policy is completely gone, and the National Health Insurance has been run aground.
That is not true. The National Health Insurance had challenges. Once again, like many things under the Mahama government, the challenges were challenges brought about by the success of the scheme. More people are joining the National Health Insurance Scheme now than when power was handed over to the NDC. We are paying over 1 billion to providers of healthcare under this government. It was in the region of about 200 or 300 million when it was handed over to us. How do those figures relate to a collapsing national health? There are challenges, and the challenges come about with the funding. It was recognized. We didn't sit down and fold our hands. President Mahama said, no. Don't let's politicize this issue. Let me have a committee put together that is nonpartisan, which is what he did. So we had a nonpartisan committee meet for almost a year, come out with recommendations which have been sent to the presidency for final look at before we begin to see how to implement the
recommendations. So it's still not that
great. But one of the issues that was raised and became immediate was a funding gap. Because we get 2.5% from VAT, we get money from SNIT, and we get subscriptions. It's the amount of subscriptions coming in and the use by our people because of the benefits of the NHIA are such that there is a gap that we cannot fill. And that therefore meant that we had to get extra revenue. And that is why President Mahama said in our manifesto that we are going to take some money from the petroleum levy under the ABFA to ensure that that gap is covered, which would mean that those that are back behind 3, 6 months, 7 months in terms of payment will eventually get their payments to bring that back them to the 3 month position, which is the acceptable norm. So we accept that there are challenges, but far, the word collapse does not exist. And those challenges are challenges because of the success of our scheme. People travel far and wide for the last 3, 4 years to come and learn about our national health insurance. Why do we put it down that way? There are challenges, but we are meeting the challenges. And I believe the CEO of the National Health Insurance did a press conference barely 2 days ago, I believe on Friday, to deal with the issues that arose. And in order not to politicize it, we didn't necessarily go and do the press conference. We said, go and do it. Tell Ghanaians what is happening really in the National Health Insurance, because as much as possible, we'll try not to politicize the National Health Insurance. But if you begin saying it's collapsed, we will have a story to tell you too. It's not collapsing. It's actually going from strength to strength. And the problems it has, John Mahama has already demonstrated that he has the answers for those problems.
After the break, we'll continue with Alex Segbefia. We'll do more broad-based politics when we come back. This is Good Evening Ghana, but it's election 2016. Few days to go before Ghanaians decide between the NDC and the MPP. The CPP doesn't like me saying that, but the decision will be one of the big parties will win the election on December 7th. We'll be right back. Welcome back. This is Good Evening Ghana, and we are still in the operating theater doing surgery on Ghana ahead of election 2016. So, Mr. Segbefia, if a new voter is looking at hearing all sorts of things and hearing the things they are hearing, there's been density of campaigning on the radio and TV. What are the issues for new voters? What are the issues that the NDC is presenting to new voters?
Well, I think that for me, the way I look at it is you have to look at one, leadership. What is being put on offer by the political parties? And in my humble opinion, the easiest is to look at who has it and what he's doing with it. So John Mahama's position is easy to knock or give credit for because he's the one in the chair. And for me, quite clearly, from what he's been able to achieve in the last 4 years and 3 months, if I can, even if I want to take account of the very difficult period when we lost President Mills, I have no doubt in my mind that his positive traits far exceed anything we've seen that his contemporaries have been able to demonstrate. And I'm talking about the behavior traits, his apparent compassion, his humbleness, his caring for mankind, and the way he even deals with children. And I also give credit to the First Lady. She has played a very important role in his governance and what has happened. And she has made even me as health minister's job easier, along with the Second Lady, because they tend to go to hospitals and health facilities to give donations, which makes it easier for me because it means that things are happening in the health sector, which I am not necessarily the person who has been going there. And I must give credit to her for the role both first and second ladies have played in assisting the presidency and the vice presidency in carrying out its roles. But going back to the direct leadership of President Mahama, everything about him is affable and presidential. And he is also not one who is quick to emotion. In other words, you don't get him angry. All he sees is, oh, there's this challenge, I must solve it. And he's also demonstrated a very high level of patriotism. Because when you even listen to him speak, it's all based on things that he remembered from when he was young. So when he spoke about Lavender Hill, he said, yeah, you know, when we used to come to Accra, we used to drive along here, this Lavender Hill, it stayed with him. And he decided I must do something about it. When he thinks about people who he has met in hospitals and there were problems, it stayed with him. And he decided I must increase. Schools, same. The education he went through and the fact that he had the ability to be in a home where there were Christian values and Muslim values, religion has never been an issue for him. He's been able to embrace all with religion. So his is not a put-on. He doesn't have to try. It is natural to his behavior pattern.
His leadership is natural.
That is it. Especially for the traits that matter. And he's very peaceful. So he doesn't look for confrontations. He's always looking for a way to deal with an issue without confrontation. When it comes, he can deal with it. He has that strength. But he doesn't look for it that way in the first place. He always tries to find a compromise scenario. And these are traits that everybody knows exist with the president. It's not me saying it, they know. So the most important aspect is that because of those traits, but his tenacity to move a country forward, what he has been able to also do is to bring about tremendous change in the environment that is Ghana. And sell us internationally, he's been second to none in terms of the way he's perceived by the international community and the way Africa has looked up to him, even when there was. And the perfect example, and people forget, is that look, when everybody was worried about Ebola, he stepped to the plate and said, these are our brothers and our sisters. They need help. And we are in Kwame Nkrumah's Ghana. That looked to set the way for Africa. We will help. So what did he do? He allowed Ghana to be the base for the United Nations group that was dealing with the Ebola issues. And apart from that, in order to let people realize that we were talking about human beings and with a difficulty and it could have been anyone, he put his health minister, a number of others, in a plane and traveled to all the three countries to show solidarity in their difficulty. And that is when the world began to wake up and realize that, look, there are issues in Africa, but actually, there's leadership in Africa. Let's see how we can help. What are you changing a person like that for? To try what do you want?
But this same message becomes ironic because you were on this program 8 years ago.
Yes.
You were on many programs on radio.
Yeah.
When you led that very powerful Professor Mills campaign that was eventually very successful.
Yeah.
And you raised questions about the MPP's two terms.
Yeah.
At the time. But here we are, there have been two terms of NDC. And the change message, and this MPP is carrying it very, very seriously. The sign for change, which you used, they are using now. Why do you think that this change message will fail? 2000 change succeeded, 2008 the change message succeeded, 2016, why will the change message fail?
The first question that came to my mind when you made the comment is that, okay, so what is original about this MPP? I mean, you have said it yourself.
2000 change succeeded.
So they use our sign?
No, 2008.
We used to say racism, you remember?
Yes.
And we used to do that. They are doing the same thing. Well, they don't have any message. NDC must always show you the way.
No, I'm talking about the change message.
You
have used the change message successfully.
Yes,
they are using it
I'm
now.
I'm saying that they are using it even in the wrong context.
Two terms.
What? No, two terms doesn't mean there should be change.
Really?
We said change because of the incompetence at the time of what was happening.
They are saying the same thing.
No, that is not what you're asking.
The most famous word of Bahumia is incompetence.
Yes,
but President Mahama has had occasion to respond to it directly.
Yes.
And very brutally too. So they are also saying change,
but
incompetence, two terms, get out of here.
So what is incompetent about the hospital we are in? And the one that is in Legon? And what is incompetent about Circle? And what is incompetent about the courts that we build? And what is incompetent about the maritime hospital that has been built? And what is incompetent about the infrastructure in fishing villages, the coastals? What is incompetent about that? If that is the definition of incompetent, call me incompetent. I will take it. If that is the definition. Mm. It is clear that this is somebody who has delivered. And when you want to even see, you say, oh, there's been a lot of loans, there's been money. You walk in and you see the money. You see what the money is. You pass in front of this building. You can see the money. It is not a case. Ghanaians, look. See, for you go to Circle, you see what people didn't think. What people thought, oh, this was just a little flyover. It went right across all the way to Awudome and came. Fantastic flyover interchange that was put in with the monument of Kwame Nkrumah for us to remember our history. And we have been here with the MPP before. What didn't they say about Kwame Nkrumah when he started the infrastructure? 1951, they took him to elections. He won. 1954, they took him to elections. He won. 1956, they took him to elections. He won. And when he became president in 1957-58, they had no choice. Because he was winning everything, they resorted to violence. I'm telling you that history is repeating itself. December 7th, John Mahama, Twasu, you win.
What is incompetent about 8 interchanges?
Which interchanges are you talking about?
Dr. Bahumia has been talking about.
You just mentioned Sufu Line, and I told you that Sufu Line is not the accredit.
Dr. Bahumia has been talking about.
The money is not a case.
What is incompetent about winning Ghana off HIPIC and bringing Ghana to middle income? Beginning Ghana from a HIPIC country, bringing it to middle income. What's incompetent about that?
Because it wasn't a homegrown policy.
What does that mean?
Our situation, even when we went to the IMF, the policies that we put in place were homegrown. And based on the homegrown policies, the IMF agreed with us. HIPIC, we had no people got up, raised their hands in exasperation, no plan, and joined HIPIC. And then the people helped you and gave you money left, right. Even monies that had been held in 2000 in 2000 that were supposed to be given to government were held back to ensure that the NDC could not, at that time, win that election. There were lots of things that happened. But history is history. But don't compare the two. There's no comparison. HIPIC
well,
is
you haven't
nothing.
Answered the question about a government that wins a country out of HIPIC and brings it to middle
and
income.
And I'm saying that the government didn't win itself out of HIPIC.
But you inherited middle income.
Yes, we did. But the issue with regard to how we even got to where we were with the IMF had a lot to do with external factors. Their situation, when we were telling them it was, they said no. They immediately came, said, we can't do anything about this, we are going HIPIC. Immediately they went HIPIC, they got. What about the death forgiveness? You are talking about money. How much money were they forgiving? And how much all the debts at the time were written off, more or less, in terms of having to pay the interest and on the loans. What did they do with it? I'm asking you again, how many hospitals? How many schools? We were forgiving under HIPIC debts. Money was, we were now able to borrow. Donor funds which we were not getting. Now, because we have lower middle income economy, we do not get the donor funds in the way. It's targeted funding. It's not good. Doesn't necessarily go to your sector budget support, into your pot. You are told, use the money for this, you use it for that. That wasn't what happened in the days of HIPIC. They got a lot of sector budget support. You are comparing chalk and cheese. And a lower middle income economy is totally different from an economy that is considered lower income.
Where would you be voting?
Where?
Where?
Hometown.
That is which constituency?
Water region.
Which constituency?
Tajuhu.
Who is the MP over there?
Aveji.
Ah, okay. Yeah. So you'll be in Volta region on voting day.
Yes.
When will you return to Accra?
voting day.
When should I call you for the results?
Oh. We will... We hope, let me put it that way, that by the evening of the 8th, we should be clear as to what is happening on the presidential front.
The trend should be clear.
Mm. I think so.
So what's your final message to voters?
Well, I think that the issues are clear, the leaders are clear, and I would entreat all and sundry to be clear in their mind about the path which Ghana has trodden over the last 8 years, and especially in the last 4 years under President Mahama. I would say to everybody, keep Ghana on the right track for development. Vote John Mahama. JM Twaso.
Thank you, Alex.
My pleasure.
Good luck.
Thank you very much. Mm.